Random House Audio presents Bad Luck and Trouble by Lee Child. Read for you by Dick Hill. Chapter 1. The man was called Calvin Franz, and the helicopter was a Bell 222. Franz had two broken legs, so he had to be loaded on board, strapped to a stretcher. Not a difficult maneuver. The Bell was a roomy aircraft, twin-engined, designed for corporate travel and police departments, with space for seven passengers. The rear doors were as big as a panel van's, and they opened wide. The middle row of seats had been removed. There was plenty of room for Franz on the floor. The helicopter was idling. Two men were carrying the stretcher. They ducked low under the rotor wash and hurried, one backward, one forward. When they reached the open door, the guy who had been walking backward got one handle up on the sill and ducked away. The other guy stepped forward and shoved hard and slid the stretcher all the way inside. Franz was awake and hurting. He cried out and jerked around a little, but not much, because the straps across his chest and thighs were buckled tight. The two men climbed in after him and got in their seats behind the missing row and slammed the doors. Then they waited. The pilot waited. A third man came out a gray door and walked across the concrete. He bent low under the rotor and held a hand flat on his chest to stop his necktie whipping in the wind. The gesture made him look like a guilty man proclaiming his innocence. He tracked around the Bell's long nose and got in the forward seat next to the pilot. "Go," he said, and then he bent his head to concentrate on his harness buckle. The pilot goosed the turbines, and the lazy whoop-whoop of the idling blade slid up the scale to an urgent centripetal whip-whip-whip, and then disappeared behind the treble blast of the exhaust. The Bell lifted straight off the ground, drifted left a little, rotated slightly, and then retracted its wheels and climbed 1,000 feet. Then it dipped its nose and hammered north, high and fast. Below it, roads and science parks and small factories and neat, isolated suburban communities slid past. Brick walls and metal siding blazed red in the late sun. Tiny emerald lawns and turquoise swimming pools winked in the last of the light. The man in the forward seat said, "You know where we're going?" The pilot nodded and said nothing. The Bell clattered onward, turning east of north, climbing a little higher, heading for darkness. It crossed a highway far below, a river of white lights crawling west and red lights crawling east. A minute north of the highway, the last developed acres gave way to low hills, barren and scrubby and uninhabited. They glowed orange on the slopes that faced the setting sun and showed dull tan in the valleys and the shadows. Then the low hills gave way in turn to small, rounded mountains. The Bell sped on, rising and falling, following the contours below. The man in the forward seat twisted around and looked down at Franz on the floor behind him, smiled briefly, and said, 20 more minutes, maybe. Franz didn't reply. He was in too much pain. The Bell was rated for a 161-mile-per-hour cruise, so 20 more minutes took it almost 54 miles, beyond the mountains, well out over the empty desert. The pilot flared the nose and slowed a little. The man in the forward seat pressed his forehead against the window and stared down into the darkness. "Where are we?" he asked. The pilot said,
"Where we were before."
"Exactly?"
"Roughly."
"What's below us now?"
"Sand."
"Height?"
3,000 feet.
"What's the air like up here?"
"Still. A few thermals, but no wind."
"Safe?"
"Aeronautically."
"So, let's do it."
The pilot slowed more and turned and came to a stationary hover 3,000 feet above the desert floor. The man in the forward seat twisted around again and signaled to the two guys way in back. Both unlocked their safety harnesses. One crouched forward, avoiding Franz's feet, and held his loose harness tight in one hand and unlatched the door with the other. The pilot was half-turned in his own seat, watching, and he tilted the Bell a little so the door fell all the way open under its own weight. Then he brought the craft level again and put it into a slow, clockwise rotation so that motion and air pressure held the door wide. The second guy from the rear crouched near Franz's head and jacked the stretcher upward to a 45-degree slope. The first guy jammed his shoe against the free end of the stretcher rail to stop the whole thing sliding across the floor. The second guy jerked like a weightlifter and brought the stretcher almost vertical. Franz sagged down against the straps. He was a big guy, and heavy, and determined. His legs were useless, but his upper body was powerful and straining hard. His head was snapping from side to side. The first guy took out a gravity knife and popped the blade, used it to saw through the strap around Franz's thighs. Then he paused a beat and sliced the strap around Franz's chest, one quick motion. At the exact same time, the second guy jerked the stretcher fully upright. Franz took an involuntary step forward onto his broken right leg. He screamed once, briefly, and then took a second instinctive step onto his broken left leg. His arms flailed, and he collapsed forward, and his upper body momentum levered him over the locked pivot of his immobile hips and took him straight out through the open door, into the noisy darkness, into the gale force rotor wash, into the night, 3,000 feet above the desert floor. For a moment there was silence. Even the engine noise seemed to fade. Then the pilot reversed the bell's rotation and rocked the other way, and the door slammed neatly shut. The turbine spun up again, and the rotor bit the air, and the nose dropped. The two guys clambered back to their seats. The man in front said, "Let's go home now." Chapter 2. 17 days later, Jack Reacher was in Portland, Oregon, short of money. In Portland, because he had to be somewhere, and the bus he had ridden 2 days previously had stopped there. Short of money, because he had met an assistant district attorney called Samantha in a cop bar, and had twice bought her dinner before twice spending the night at her place. Now she had gone to work, and he was walking away from her house, 9 o'clock in the morning, heading back to the downtown bus depot, hair still wet from her shower, sated, relaxed, destination as yet unclear, with a very thin wad of bills in his pocket. The terrorist attacks of September 11, 2001, had changed Reacher's life in two practical ways. Firstly, in addition to his folding toothbrush, he now carried his passport with him. Too many things in the new era required photo ID, including most forms of travel. Reacher was a drifter, not a hermit, restless, not dysfunctional, and so he had yielded gracefully. And secondly, he had changed his banking methods. For many years after leaving the Army, he had operated a system whereby he would call his bank in Virginia and ask for a Western Union wire transfer to wherever he happened to be. But new worries about terrorist financing had pretty much killed telephone banking, so Reacher had gotten an ATM card. He carried it inside his passport and used 8197 as his PIN. He considered himself a man of very few talents, but some varied abilities, most of which were physical and related to his abnormal size and strength, but one of which was always knowing what time it was without looking, and another of which was some kind of a junior idiot savant facility with arithmetic, hence 8197. He liked 97 because it was the largest two-digit prime number, and he loved 81 because it was absolutely the only number out of all the literally infinite possibilities whose square root was also the sum of its digits. Square root of 81 was 9. And 8 and 1 made 9. No other non-trivial number in the cosmos had that kind of sweet symmetry. Perfect. His arithmetic awareness and his inherent cynicism about financial institutions always compelled him to check his balance every time he withdrew cash. He always remembered to deduct the ATM fees, and every quarter he remembered to add in the bank's paltry interest payment. And despite his suspicions, he had never been ripped off. Every time, his balance came up exactly as he predicted. He had never been surprised or dismayed. Until that morning in Portland, where he was surprised, but not exactly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.